I will show you an exam revision process that will help you save time, score better, and learn more effectively. If you know how your professors design exams, you'll be able to focus on exactly what matters. I've created more than 100 college exams myself. I will show you the exam preparation process and how to anticipate the right exam questions. While doing so, I will mention the top 5 evidence-based learning technique recommendations you can apply to study for exams. The study from Donlusky et al. Also highlights the 5 least effective techniques. If you're using any of those, think about investing your time in one of the more effective methods. When you prepare yourself for an exam, you consider all the study material available: lecture slides, exercises, books, whatever your professor uses. In the next step, many students take notes. They highlight texts, create dozens of pages of summaries, draw images, and so on. There are many videos about note-taking on YouTube. There's nothing that says note-taking is particularly bad. It's fine to do so, but only if you're good and fast at it, because it takes a lot of time, and notes alone are not sufficient for exam preparation. In fact, all the 5 low-utility techniques from Donlusky's study can be found in this part of the process. Summarization is considered low-utility. If you're not skilled at summarizing, it consumes a lot of time while the effectiveness of learning is not significantly boosted. Highlighting and underlining do little to boost performance and may actually hurt performance on higher-level tasks that require inference making. Rereading wasn't found to be useful. Keyword mnemonic too is not recommended. It's unlikely that you'll remember your random mnemonics later. Imagery is only useful for very imagery-friendly material, but rated as low utility in general. There's no need to draw images from all your texts. Let's go from your notes to the exam preparation material. The most effective learning technique, according to Donlusky, is practice testing. If you can anticipate all relevant exam questions and their variations, you should be solid. If you get this part right, you could even skip the whole note-taking process, save a lot of time, and focus on what matters. Instead of pages of summaries, highlights, and side notes that you must review anyway, you can focus on solving maybe 100 or 200 questions that cover the core of the whole subject. The next step is to apply learning methods to study this material before we attend the exam. But first, let's talk about the exam preparation material in detail. The exam preparation material is directly linked to another overlooked part in the process, the course syllabus. The course syllabus contains the learning outcomes, those things that your professor wants you to know or be able to do when you complete the course. The exam questions will reflect those core learning outcomes. Imagine your course like a tree. The trunk is made of the learning outcomes. In the exam, you have to prove that you got this. Then you have thousands of branches and 10,000 leaves. Those are all the side infos, anecdotes, examples, complex derivations, and so on that fill most of the slides and textbooks. That makes the tree more beautiful, and it's important for the narrative of the course. But you're not expected to have all of that memorized. Don't let anyone tell you that everything is equally important. No, knowledge and skills must be prioritized. I want you to develop an eye for identifying what's most relevant and build a strong trunk. That goes for your exam preparation and for your learning progress. If you're lucky, your professor will provide an exam questions catalog that covers questions about all relevant exam topics. I do that for my courses. I don't want my students to poke around in the dark trying to identify what matters most. Obviously, the questions on the exam paper are not posed exactly like in the catalog. I use variations that prevent anyone from passing the exam by merely memorizing things. My students could skip all classes and just focus on the exam catalog from the beginning. It would save them a lot of time. Don't do that. Nonetheless, every single one of them participates actively. College is not just about passing exams. Students form a community with a joint mission. Regular classes offer a good opportunity to exchange knowledge and thoughts. Quite often, you'll find old exams, exercises in the course material, exercises in books, or even online. Is that sufficient for exam revision? No, because each exam may only cover some parts of the learning outcomes. We will use that material, of course, but we need a comprehensive list of exam questions that covers the whole range of learning outcomes. Old exams only help us fill that list. The key takeaway here is that you want to have your own complete set of questions that you anticipate will be in the exam. You can do that better when you know how your professors create exams. To demonstrate this, I'm going to use a simple example that everyone can understand. Exam questions about Pythagoras' theorem. I know that your courses and mine are a lot more complex, but this will do to show the basic principles. Let's say the basic math course syllabus states the following 3 learning outcomes, amongst others. The student shall be able to Name basic mathematical terms and formulas. Apply basic trigonometrical formulas and derive basic trigonometrical formulas. Educators often use Bloom's taxonomy for creating learning outcomes and exam questions. Bloom's taxonomy divides learning into different levels of complexity. It starts with basic knowledge, meaning recalling basic facts and concepts. It ends with creating on your own, let's say a new product or a new point of view on a topic. The exams of most technical courses and many basic courses in college focus on this range on the left of the taxonomy. Exams in some non-technical areas like law and social sciences often focus on the right side of the taxonomy. The same goes for project-based technical courses, which are mostly not graded by an exam, but by the project results. With Pythagoras' theorem, I'm using a simple example for the left side of the taxonomy. The taxonomy provides key verbs that help educators formulate learning outcomes and exam questions. I put a link in the description to a comprehensive table. Here I'll just take three example verbs for each category. Under remember, we'll find verbs like naming, recognizing, and writing. The first learning outcome from the syllabus goes in this category. Let's go back to the slide and identify potential exam questions that fit into this category. Let's start with the obvious one. We'll take write down Pythagoras' theorem as a question and write the answer. Since we're also supposed to know basic terms, I think we should somehow memorize hypotenuse and we should be able to recognize if the theorem is applicable to all triangles. As you can see, I've created two questions about that. In many courses, you have lots of terms and rules. It may not be effective to create a question for each term. In that case, formulate questions like name the 10 characteristics of XYZ or state 5 rules for XYZ. We can't identify a learning outcome that would go in the understand category, but we have this one for the apply category. The slide already provides an exercise and we want to use that question and answer. We can also come up with alternative questions. Normally, you'll get a better feeling for this when looking through exercise sheets, online sources, and old exams. We assign the last learning outcome to the analyze column. If the professor covered the derivation of the theorem in class, we write a respective question and answer. We don't have any learning outcomes in the evaluate and create columns. Looking back at the slide, it means that some information is not relevant for the exam. You don't have to create a table like I did. Have Bloom's taxonomy open in a browser tab. Simply go through all course material, identify and write down questions on a blank sheet or a flashcard. Complement your questions catalog with questions from old exams and online sources. I want to throw in two techniques mentioned in the study by Donlosky that were rated as moderate. One is self-explanation, meaning explaining your steps when solving a problem and linking new information to known information. The second is elaborative interrogation, meaning explaining why a stated fact or concept is true. Keep that in mind while creating your questions and answers. Now that we have a questions catalog, we'll need to study it. There are many YouTube videos about exam preparation methods. I promise I'm not going to tell you to get a lot of sleep, eat healthy, take breaks, etc. That's all good, but you know that already. I studied for all my exams simply by creating a questions catalog, skipping highlighting, note-taking, and summarizing. For implementing your questions catalog, you can either use flashcards on paper or flashcard tools like Anki. Any active recall method with any tool of your preference. One of the top rated learning techniques according to Donlosky is distributed practice or spaced repetition. That means you spread out your activities over time. Have a look at the Ebbinghaus forgetting curve. Naturally, you forget information over time. The more often you repeat that information in intervals, the deeper the information becomes manifested. If you study all content a week before the exam, your brain will forget most of the information a few days after the exam. My recommendation is that you create your exam questions once a week during the semester. Don't do it during class, but after the sessions. After a week, go to your professor and let him or her have a quick look. He or she can tell you if you should focus on something else. Then go through your questions in defined intervals during the semester. Instead of studying for 20 hours before the exam, spread those 20 hours over the semester. Don't waste time by constantly repeating the questions that you're already good at. Focus more on your problem areas. If you have a study group, synchronize your questions catalogs and prepare exams for each other. you may come up with different variations of questions. You can explain the results to each other, which fosters the self-explanation technique in even a more effective way. Another recommended technique by Domlosky is interleaved practice. Mix different topics and study formats in your study schedule. Use different question types. Switch subjects instead of studying one subject for several hours. A final tip from me personally. Go through your post-exam review session every time. In most cases, students can get a point or more. Professors can make mistakes while grading. Some answers may be ambiguous and still be counted with the right arguments. I always appreciate a like. Subscribe to StudyFox if you want to get more tips in the future. I wish you good luck on your exams.